big thanks, because this whole thing wouldn't be possible without you. So all the conference participators, and of course, the people who provide the talk, huge thanks. And also our sponsors, which can be found here during the breaks. And in this moment, I'll announce, so Pekka, Pekka Klärck, welcome.
Thanks, Ismo, for introductions, and thanks everybody for getting here. I've been involved with Robot Framework for over 10 years, and this first RoboCon and being here with that many people is truly awesome. As Ismo said, when we got the idea that we all want to organize a conference, we thought that, well, if we got 100 people, that's like awesome, and we are, well, 2.5 times more, so really, really great. And as Ismo said, well, thanks for all the sponsors, speakers, and, well, obviously, most importantly, the audience. In this presentation, my main topic is going to actually cover that long journey from the very early prototypes of Robot Framework to the via open sourcing to the present day. And then at the end also, we're going to take a quick look at what the future might bring us, kind of in the near future, what is, well, pretty, kind of certainly happening, and also kind of wish list that what things that might be there in the future. As many of you here know, this framework is based on my master's thesis, or to be more precise, the prototypes I did for my master's thesis already over 10 years ago. Back then, I had already worked as a test engineer and test automation engineer several years, and had implemented various kind of automation frameworks for different kind of contexts and different domains. And I had noticed that regardless of the domain, there's always kind of similar needs. I always need to have some kind of way to pass the test data. I always need a logger, and a lot of common components. So that was my kind of motivation for the thesis, to study that, okay, what kind of common components could we create so that when I next time I'm writing or implementing a custom framework with some needs, I don't need to reinvent all the wheels. So I had that earlier experience from earlier projects, and also then did extensive literature study that tried to find all the basically articles about automation frameworks, as well as read all the books about the topic, and well, started with the prototypes. The major learning was that not only can we create those common components, but we can actually implement this kind of totally generic framework, generic but extendable framework, so that the core is generic, but we can extend with then system-specific, domain-specific libraries. The architecture of the framework nowadays is this, and back in those prototype days, it was very similar. There was some other kind of stuff still around, but. No need to show that, but this is the current architecture, and very close to what I did already back then, 2004-2005. So on top, there's test data in certain syntax. That syntax has, of course, varied a lot. I'm going to shortly show some examples from those early prototypes. But the concept is more or less the same still. And the concept, the main idea was, from the very beginning, that this test data should be in format that also non-technical people, also non-technical testers who are domain experts, can help in automation. So that automation shouldn't be only something that the developers can do, or something that only dedicated automation engineers can do. So that also that normal testers, having possibly not that much programming skills, should be able to participate. The data then, there is parsed by the framework. Wasn't called Robot Framework back then, but anyway, the part by the framework, and based on the data, the framework then start executing test cases. The framework, well, the most promising prototype that I did for the thesis and the current framework also is fully keyword-driven, so that the test cases are constructed from keywords, and then those keywords are implemented in libraries, and that's then the libraries are the ones that are interacting with the system under test. So although the idea was that non-technical testers can participate in writing automated tests, I already know that for actually interacting with the system under test, which is more complicated, there I don't want to use any kind of a toy language. I want to have real programming languages. And the framework has been implemented already in the early prototypes with Python. So Python is the most kind of a common language to use there, but also Java has been supported from nearly from the beginning. So that's the architecture. And of course, there on the bottom, the most important box for you, the system.test. Libraries can communicate with the system.test directly, or if you have a useful test tool available, you can wrap that into library so that the functionality of the test tool is then exposed to the framework via the library. And here, as I promised, example from the very first prototype that eventually led to Robot Framework. Very similar in a sense. There's a test case names there on the left, keywords and arguments. Kind of the biggest difference compared to nowadays, it was there's a separate column for documentation. Turned out that you don't need documentation that often, so that the extra column makes no sense. And also, this old format was, it was in spreadsheet program, tabular format that was then parsed. But it was still already back then keyword-driven. So we have keywords, input, equals there in the first one, and then input, add, and equals in the second one. So with these keywords, you create those test cases. And the idea was, of course, that if keywords are provided for these non-technical testers, they can still create new test cases out of this. But only the lowest level keywords are often come from those libraries. So we had the in the architecture, the library there is interacting with the system under test. And especially if the library is generic, the keywords that it provides are often very low level, highly technical. And if you would only use those to construct your test cases could, would become long, they would become hard to understand, hard to maintain, and also have a lot of duplication and a lot of kind of unnecessary details there. So that was back in the day, on the prototype days, already then I wanted it to make it better so that still using keywords, but you could also create keywords here in the test data. Obviously, you can also create higher level keywords in the library. So if you want to have domain specific keywords, you can do that in the library. But then that requires programming skills. And the idea was that we wanted to be possible to create good automated tests without such skills. So yeah. There were these higher level keywords, or user keywords, as they are called in robot framework terminology. And they were already supported by this very early prototype. So here is, for example, that keyword add implemented. And also here, separate column for documentation. But then the actual implementation is very close to what's there nowadays. This add keyword accepts an argument. And then when it's called, this keyword, it activates the calculator, sends the plus symbol, and then inputs the whatever number was given. Also, already that time, there were libraries. So here is a part of the library that was used by the earlier test cases. There are some differences compared to how libraries look nowadays, as people who have been writing libraries probably notice. One thing is that we were using keywords like launch, send, and activate there. And now these methods, that how they are implemented, they have this handler postfix at the end, which is not used anymore. And a bigger difference is that nowadays, these keywords, as we'll see soon, get arguments that are used with those keywords in test data directly, and here they got some kind of a keyword object where you need query to argument. So API was much more complicated, and not as nice as it's nowadays. But still, concepts were the same. At that point then, I had these prototypes ready. I was thinking, that, okay, that would be a cool open source project, but I was thinking also that okay, this is going to be a really, really big task to do it. And at that point, got kind of lucky. An old colleague of mine contacted me. We had been working together in one of those early automation projects that I had. And that project hadn't been a total kind of a disaster. And he kind of needed, okay, I know something about this. This colleague of mine, Petri Haapio, who might be here, at least I invited him, he had just joined Nokia Networks, and they needed an automation solution in a very heterogeneous environment, and contacted me that, okay, do I have any ideas how this should be handled? And I was, of course, that, hey, yeah, sure, I have these prototypes, I've been just working with this, and this is much better than what we did earlier, so I want to come to show it to you. So I went there with the company that I worked back then, and they liked the idea, and we started implementing a framework for their needs. Of course, this framework was implemented for this certain project needs, but I had all the time the vision that keep the core generic so that it could also be used elsewhere. And that happened. The other team started taking into use, adding new custom libraries for their needs, and then the usage spread rather rapidly and organically within the company. There started to be hundreds of users and thousands of users and so on. We had only a small team there. There was like long-term, early team members were me. Then there was Juha Rantanen from the very beginning, and Janne Härkönen also. Janne is there, hi. Juha unfortunately couldn't get here. He's in Dubai or somewhere, so kind of a good excuse, I guess. But yeah, so we had a relatively small team supporting a lot of users. What we did, of course, was just make it life easier for those teams. And a lot of that, what that meant often was organizing training courses for them, but also then developing the framework further. That's what test data looked in robot framework 0. something. So I think I'm not exactly sure, but I'm really sure that this is from autumn 2005, before the 1.0 release that was in early 2004. Now it's getting closer to what it's nowadays. If you look at the test case table, it's fairly close to what we have now. The documentation is not anymore in a separate column, it's a setting. Setting name has just changed from document to documentation, but otherwise, more or less the same that we have nowadays. Variable table, exactly the same. But then in the settings table, weird stuff that is not supported anymore. You provide log file names and whatever from the command line these days. Of course, big difference to what you see nowadays is that this is an HTML format. That was the original format that Robot Framework supported back in the early days. The prototype had this spreadsheet, but now it was HTML. HTML tables. Also, well, early days we had user keywords, and this, by the way, would work exactly like it's now present day, so there's no syntax differences really. And we had libraries, and also the library API from those early days at Nokia is the same, more or less, as now. We have now keyword launch, check title, and so on. No handler postfixes there anymore. And also, these keywords get the arguments directly. So, for example, there's the launch method there, implementing a keyword launch. And then it's used here, passing the host name and path. And the keyword gets them directly. So, much cleaner API. So, there hasn't actually been much changes for this kind of static API. But then additional APIs have been added. Most important, the dynamic library API, which hasn't been used that much earlier, but now Selenium library 3 took that into use, and that's something that we are going to hear a bit more. There's a Tatu Aalto is going to present about Selenium library and how to extend it, and you'll probably hear a bit more about this dynamic API as well. In the early days, the log file looked something like this. So not at all what we have nowadays, just basically HTML table with timestamp and who is logging and level and messages. So it's just one, nothing to collapse on or anything. So that's, of course, something where there have been a lot of changes. So we developed the framework further at Nokia, and I decided to get more and more promising, and I was also thinking that, okay, that this really should be open source, but I was kind of worried that, well, we are here in a big corporation, how is that ever going to work? Should I leave here and start something like this from scratch and a separate project or what? But then this Petri that I mentioned earlier, he was about to leave Nokia at some point there, but he made a heroic fight with Nokia lawyers, and we actually got a permission to open source. I still don't know how that happened, but we got a permission to open source the framework, and that did happen in the summer 2008, so we're like half a year less from the 10-year anniversary of the open sourcing. So that's something. I probably would have implemented something similar if that hadn't worked. But yeah, of course, what we had back then was a great help. And the great thing was also that Nokia still continued to support developers. Nokia continued sponsoring the development. So although it was open source, our team was still there helping the teams and implementing the framework further. Nokia sponsoring ended only 2015. Yeah, when the framework was open sourced, very rich ecosystem started forming. We released some project libraries ourselves. And I think the first external library provided by the community was called AutoID library. And the nice thing here is that we have Martin Taylor here, who is the guy who implemented and released that. That was a really big thing for us to see that, okay, somebody cares about this and makes this kind of libraries available. So Martin is going to speak also in the afternoon. It's a nice thing. Another big thing that the community has provided us is that is Selenium 2 library, which was a fork of Selenium library that our team at Nokia was developing. Selenium 2 library using WebDriver APIs. And one of the leading forces there was Ed, who is also talking here, presenting here. So we have a lot of these guys from the early days present and even presenting, which is awesome. So, where are we now? First of all, the framework is very well used around the world in totally different kind of contexts. Web testing is one big thing, but it's really, really popular actually in embedded devices, testing REST interfaces, protocols, databases, all kind of different kind of contexts. That's, well, initially kind of my idea was. And also in many places it's used in situations where tests involve both web and embedded or something. So it's not only that you use it in one kind of domain, you can use it in an environment where you need to interact with all of these different interfaces. In Finland, this framework is especially popular. It's kind of a de facto standard nowadays for this kind of a high-level acceptance testing. And there are some kind of big names. Then we couldn't possibly list all the companies in Finland using the framework, so this is some of the big ones. And also here, a good thing is that, well, Nokia is still using it, but if you look at the schedule, you can see that after my presentation here and after the break, we are going to get case examples from Kone and Opus Capita. So really looking forward to that. There's Deo and Aldina presenting. And we're also going to get should have a third case presentation, which is then about Plone, how they use the framework. Plone, this open source project. And well, as Ismo told, the development is nowadays supported by the Robot Framework Foundation. So Nokia sponsorship ended in the sense that, well, Nokia didn't anymore have this team of external developers. They insourced everything. They still are using it. That didn't change. They're still using it, but they're just not anymore developing the core further. As I think most people here know, that's what the test data looks. It's still keyword-driven, but most of the time, test data is in plain text format, not anymore in HTML tables or spreadsheet tables. It's still kind of tabular, so that didn't change. But well, it's this format is so much easier to edit in any text editor and works much better in version control system than HTML and so on. So that's what people are mostly using these days. But anyway, the syntax itself hasn't changed that much. The big, really, really big change, if you compare to the early robot framework days at Nokia, is this logs and reports. Earlier, as I well showed you, it was just, well, initially it was just this kind of a HTML table, and it's not very good if you start having hundreds or thousands of test cases. As everybody using robot framework, well, knows, if this would be a real, not just an image, I could somewhere here click on those test suites and it would open, so and I would open test cases and keywords and drill down to in the information there so that I don't have everything like that. I remember when the first version of that was implemented, it was actually quite, it might have been even in Robot Framework 1.0, but well, it was after the example that I just showed. That was done by a guy called Lasse Koskala, who was working in a team for a little time. And I remember when he implemented that JavaScript thing that makes it collapse and expand, I was like, wow, that's black magic. I had no idea. I had no JavaScript experience. I didn't know you can do something like that with static HTML files. So, but yeah. But nowadays, things, well, are totally different from that also, because we had a problem that these log files and reports, they started to grow big when you start having more test cases. And then two other long-term team members, Jussi Malinen and Mikko Korpela, they had a vision how they could make it smaller, and nowadays the log file is totally dynamically created. So when you open it, its elements, they are created. And so it's, if you ever look at the source code, it's just basically templates and data in a very strange format. So that was a big thing. And also, Jussi might be here, and Mikko is here. I already saw him, and he's presenting also about Pabot, the parallel execution tool, at the end. So, what kind of plans are there for the near future? One is to get Robot Framework 3.0.3 out soon. There are already some smallest bug fixes and enhancements done, have been there a long time, waiting for a release. But well, there are also still a few issues that need to be done. And we're going to have a development sprint tomorrow. So if there's anybody who is interested to contribute, you can come. It's at FE Code office. We'll probably have some more information about that still later. But you can come there, and you can contribute there with Robot Framework to Selenium library. Tatu is going to be there, and there are other projects as well. But my plan is that after these sprints, next week or week after, then I try to create the release so that everything done in those sprints will be released also. But that's anyway going to be a relatively small release, no new major features or anything. But then, Robot Framework 3.1 is going to contain bigger changes. I hope I have a chance to start working with it this year. That's kind of depends on foundation sponsoring, because I'm going to need to pay my bills and eat. So if the foundation doesn't have enough money to for kind of a longer term sponsoring, then I may need to do more kind of a normal consultation work, which I do for a living. But assuming we would get some more money, hopefully we can get that started, because it's going to be a bit bigger project. And of course, I hope and expect the community to help there also. One of the big things planned, I'm kind of thinking, would be adding a skip status to test cases. So at the moment, test cases can either pass or fail. But there's sometimes a situation that you notice that during execution, okay, this cannot be executed for various reasons, and then it would be better to skip it. There are ways to work around this issue with those non-critical failures, but that's a bit awkward. And also, skip is what other frameworks are using, so I expect people to be more kind of familiar with that. But that's going to be surprisingly big change. There's a long discussion about issue tracker about that, mainly because we already have this criticality feature that is somehow similar and need to decide how do they work together, or can they actually work together? Do we need to remove the other feature if we add this, and so on. If you have ideas, come chat here or during the sprints. Well, we are definitely not going to implement it during the sprints, because it's going to be a big task, but there's a lot to talk about the design still. In that version, I kind of expect there to be some enhancement for handling lists and mappings in the data, that kind of data structures. They are very much used in REST APIs, for example, when you get JSON replies, and having better support in the framework itself to handle those data structures would be nice. That might require some changes to the syntax, nothing major, but something. And also enhancement for the collections library that is provided with the framework. So that definitely could be enhanced. And that old HTML support, HTML test data, the original one that we supported in Robot Framework 1.0, is most likely going to be dropped. The support for that is going to be dropped. Or at least it's going to be deprecated. If there are a lot of people still using that, we can consider just deprecating it. But it will eventually go away, and I'll explain shortly why. Another thing that kind of must happen in the near future, that's probably happening before Robot Framework 3.1, is SSS library 3 with Python 3 support. So SSS library nowadays, I think the biggest library in the ecosystem that still doesn't support Python 3, which is, by the way, something where you should be moving. So Python 2 support is going to end 2020, which is like 2 years from now. So If you are implementing libraries and so on, you definitely should take Python 3 into account. I know that there's going to be a new library for REST and JSON testing. And why do I know? How do I know it? Well, I read it from the schedule. Anssi is going to present about that in the afternoon. He's been working with this really cool thing. It's not just about requests and so on. It's high level, but well, I'm not going to steal his talk, so let him see present. But yeah, that's something that will be very interesting. So that was stuff that I know is going to happen. Well, Robot Framework 3.0 is kind of when it's going to happen. It's going to happen, hopefully this year, maybe later, but anyway. These are then kind of longer-term wish list with things that I hope could happen. Some are things that I know I'm going to work with, and others are things that I kind of hope that others maybe can help more. One is that I'd really like to rewrite the test data parser of the framework so that we could add more features into it. One feature that's somewhat controversial is that I'd like to add a native support for if-else structures in the data. I definitely don't want to see that kind of programmatic features used on test case level, but on lower level in those user keywords, you often need something like this. And we already have this run keyword if that you can use, but it's a bit hackish and a bit awkward. So native support in the language would be much better, much cleaner. But that kind of bigger changes with the current parser are not impossible, but annoying to do. So that's one reason I want to draw out this HTML support, well, the primary reason. And so we only would support plain text format. And then we can actually add stuff like this. Then I have an idea that maybe this parser logic could be then having been an external component so that it could be used also for other purposes. Maybe as a kind of a DevOps language so that you wouldn't then call it a test case because that doesn't make in other contexts, but you could have a script that you could write perhaps using robot frameworks for syntax. And then those kind of script steps could call into libraries, just like with robot frameworks. So that might be a neat thing, but that's not kind of tied to test data. Well, it's tied to test data parser rewrite, so that the rewrite must happen for this other thing to be a reality. But the rewrite may happen also without it. That's something that I kind of hope I have a chance to work. But if there are people here who are into kind of parsers and lexers and so on, that would be a really cool thing to collaborate in this parser rewrite. Then there's better editor support. It's really great that the community has provided so many plugins for various IDEs and text editors, but of course, many of them could still get better. One thing that we noticed that when this Selenium 3 library, for example, took this dynamic library API into use, we noticed that, well, not all editors or most editors don't actually support that. There's other things that could be done. This is, of course, hard in a sense that the people have different kind of needs. Some people want to use Eclipse, others want to use IntelliJ-based editors, others want to have a standalone editor, or somebody's using Emacs. So if the people have different kind of needs, then we kind of needed to have good plugins for all of those. But well, at least having some kind of a good, some better plugins than what we nowadays have for the most common editors would be great. So that's definitely something. Well, something I hope we'll get. That's also something where I don't think I can help much because I don't have experience from that. I don't have much experience writing UI GUI programs in general. I have hands full of other work, but I can help otherwise as much as I can. One thing that I like to do also, well, get done at some point, is enhancing the user guide. That might sound a bit strange because the user guide is really kind of a strong asset for the framework. Not all tools, open source tool, or even commercial tool have such a great reference manual as Robot Framework's user guide. But it still could be made better. One thing that could be done is that it could be changed from the current kind of a custom format to something else, perhaps Sphinx, which is what Python uses for its standard library documentation. It has search functionality there built in and would make hosting easier and so on. So that's the one thing. And then it would definitely need some kind of a general proofreading and editing to make it more consistent. It's been written over the years, different people writing different parts, so it's not at all consistent book. The idea is not to make it any kind of a bestseller novel. It's not going to win the Pulitzer Prize or anything, but I think still think it could be made better. So the user guide, it is still already in the current form a great resource. reference guide. But what would be great also to have still more tutorials and demos to help new people get started. Because if you don't know, especially if you don't know much about automation, if you just start reading the user guide, it's very hard to know what you should do in the beginning. So that kind of demos would be great. So if you have ideas, that's something where it's, of course, great if you can contribute. And well, book would be great. I personally prefer so much more writing code than writing kind of text. That's the reason I haven't done it at least earlier, but it's still kind of long overdue. So yeah, wanted to add it here, kind of, okay, that's, I know that should be done. And that's also something maybe where if somebody is interested to collaborate, that might be easier. But yeah, that would be a really, really good thing. Kind of still on the wish list kind of things, making the framework more popular outside Finland. So in Finland, as a result, told, it's kind of a de facto standard. It's used widely around the world, but not as widely as here. So there are a lot of people who still don't know about it and so on. I don't, of course, mean that everybody should be using it. It's not a tool that, it's not any kind of a silver bullet that would solve all the problems and all acceptance test automation should be done with it. But it would, of course, be good if more people knew about it so that when they have a situation where it might work, they would have that as an option. If they don't know about this tool, of course, if they have a suitable, if they have a use case for it, and they then have no idea that this kind of thing exists, well, they won't use it, obviously. So yeah, we are planning, as I'm told, to extend the foundation outside Finland. We want to help people start meetups and local events. And we, of course, want to have more RoboCon. Assuming that this day here is not a total disaster, at least at the moment it looks pretty good. So we want to have a conference again held in Helsinki or, well, somewhere close by. But maybe then RoboCon US at some point, not sure if it's next year or year after, RoboCon Asia, whatever. So that would be, of course, really, really nice. But we definitely want to have these annual conferences here and maybe somewhere elsewhere. But that requires having some kind of local community, of course. So, how can you help with those wish lists? One thing is just spreading the word. The more we get new users, the bigger the community gets, the more we have hands developing new libraries and so on. So that's all good. So you can recommend the framework to colleagues at work, on mailing lists, participate there in different, not only robot framework mailing list, of course, but on general testing mailing list or other forums. If you have local testing meetups, agile meetups or conferences, then you can propose robot framework related topics there. I mean, you can give an introduction. You can use, of course, all the materials that's available on our robot framework pages. You can use those slides if you don't want to create your own. So presenting in kind of that kind of conferences, meetups would be great. And if there's enough interest in your local area, maybe start a local robot framework meetup group that has worked very well here in Helsinki and also in smaller cities in Finland. Then obviously contributing kind of code and documentation and testing contribution to existing projects is great, and well, even better perhaps that if you have some new stuff to add to the ecosystem, that would be really, really nice. And well, assuming that Robot Framework Foundation spreads outside Finland, try to get your company to join, and that we can then sponsor the development even more. And that's what I had to say, but there's room for questions. So we have these two gentlemen here giving microphones.
Hi, I have a question. For example, our company, we have like a lot of extensions for the robot framework, but they are all internal. Mm. If we want to publish one, under what kind of license we have to do it? AGPL or?
That's something that you can actually choose totally yourself.
Okay.
So the idea has been from the beginning that we have core framework that has obviously certain license, and then you can how you contribute to that is one thing, but if you want to start your own project, it's your own project, and you can make all that kind of decisions. Robot framework itself and most of the tooling in the ecosystem is licensed under Apache 2, but if that's not suitable for you for some reason, you use something else. It doesn't matter, really. So it's totally up to you.
Okay. Thank you.
Hi, René Roda from Germany. Maybe I will extend, or I want to extend this question. What's the requirement that you publish the libraries we wrote or extensions somebody wrote in his company to be published at the robotframework.org?
You just ask.
We are maybe interested to make it open source, but maybe want to written our name as the idea given company or something like this. Is this possible, or what do you think?
Basically, you just ask. If you go to robotframework.org, I don't think I have a network here, I cannot go there, but close to all of these sections about, okay, here are some libraries and so on, there's something like link saying, let us know if you want something to be added. And that takes you to to GitHub, where this GitHub project, the robotframework.org is on GitHub pages. So this link gets you to GitHub, where there's a project. Where you can submit an issue or pull request if you want to, and then we'll add it. So that's how it goes, basically. And of course, it's okay to add kind of small attribution to, okay, this is library done by this company and so on, if you want to. And then if people go to your project basis, then of course it's totally up to you what you have there. So the project is yours, but it's very easy to get those stuff added there. We are, by the way, working on, kind of related to this, we are working on rewrite of the robotframework.org, not rewrite so that the content is going to be the same, but we are going to use the new visual identity, this what Ismo and, well, this t-shirts and what we have, also what the RoboCon conference pages had. So that's going to be there, but it didn't make it to the conference, but it will be available somewhat soon.
Other questions?
You announced that you want to expand the foundation worldwide or something like this.
Yeah.
Do you have a time agenda for this?
Basically,
rough.
Post-conference, we have been lately, have had our hands full with this conference preparations and so on, but I think something should happen this year. I kind of expect that European countries should be easy. We don't know the laws and all that stuff. So that should be pretty fairly easy. I kind of expect that, but we don't know. Then for the US, then we need to have something else there, so kind of a separate entity. But we are going to hopefully get something done this year.
Yeah, and we have decided already that in next years our agenda is going to be international, but let's see what wide it's going to be.
Yeah.
All right. Thank you, Pekka. Okay.